You are familiar with these two terms, being in Christ and Christ in you. Cristo en ti, la esperanza de gloria. And we've been discussing this, and we've been looking at it, but we've been trying to look at it from a different angle, different point of view. And so we talked about Christ in you, being enfolded in Christ is the term that I used. So if you could imagine a person, which Jesus is a person, being taken and being enfolded into that person. In other words, you're there, but you're enfolded into that person. That sort of hopefully awakens us to something beyond just in Christ, something beyond just a circle, something beyond, particularly something beyond just a doctrine of being in Christ, to be enfolded into this one and all that he is and all that he knows and all of his ways, and to be brought into something that is foreign, but may I say wonderfully foreign. Wonderfully foreign. And finding ourselves there, we are literally in an environment. An environment of thoughts that are not our own, of ways that are not our own. And really and truly, an admission of a person that we're not familiar with. I mean, when we actually come to that place, instead of thinking we know it all, you know, I mean, and we do, I think, to some degree, you know. I mean, in certain circumstances, we go, well, I don't know everything, but we get over here, and, you know, well, don't tell me. I know that stuff. And then, so that's being in Christ. And this is the, what we termed as, where did I put it here? The settled death. The settled death happened in him because we are crucified in Christ. That is the only reality of our death that counts. There is no other death that counts. That death. Okay? And so, and to talk about Christ in us, get this, is not even a reality until we have entered into his death, so that we might walk in newness of life, okay? So it would be ashamed, maybe you agree with me, it would be ashamed to claim a doctrine of this while living contrary to it, and it would be ashamed, you know, I mean, it would just be ashamed, not, and I'm not talking about putting shame on you. I'm talking about, it would be a shame to miss this environment and to miss the enfolding, if you will, because we chose a chalk circle or because we chose a doctrine, you know. And so, but the same with being in Christ, there is an enfolding. And remember, we've been using that term and some other ones instead of just in Christ, Christ in us. There's an enfolding of him into us. You know. And he is enfolded into us as life and as nature. Okay. Now, remember our scripture in Galatians. This is going to go quick, isn't it? Galatians 2:19 says that we are dead that we might live unto God. Dead that with the purpose of living unto God. Okay, so here it is. Here it is. I am crucified in Christ. That's the eternal reality. That's the unchangeable truth. That's the settled death. And when we find this, and we find it truly not based on us, because based on us is not first. And too many times, we make everything based on us. We look at ourselves, we evaluate everything, and there's a time, actually, for doing that, but it is absolutely futile to look down here unless this in Christ reality has been branded into us, branded into our being, so that it's immovable, so that it is as stable as the person that it represents, Jesus. Okay, so so I'm going to just read a little statement, because what we've kind of been doing here is we went from the tabernacle to the altar last week. Do y'all kind of remember that? The tabernacle building, the tent. We went from that to the altar, and this week what we want to do is go from the altar to the laver. Okay. We want to just make a move. No, I'm sorry. We want to make a progression. We don't want to make moves. We don't just want to be moving and active and, you know, busy. We want to make a progression. All right, so let me read this statement. First, and when we say first, we're talking about here in Christ, enfolded in him. First, there are those priests who were bound together to build a place on earth where Christ crucified may be seen and where he may be inhabited. Because we in him, we move and live and move and have our being. We are inhabiting him first before he ever inhabits us. We are in him. And when we say we're in him, if we don't emphasize the him, the person, what did I call it a couple of weeks ago? The him of the him. If we're not there, then we're just claiming a Messiah, a Christ, that has no effect upon us other than he's far away and we can pray to him or get things, you know, get things from him. So first, there are those priests who were bound together to build a place on earth, where Christ crucified may be seen and inhabited. We're talking about the tabernacle tent. In other words, they are bringing what is above down into the earth. Down into the earth. You can't bring something that's from above down to the earth unless you know what that is. You can know it by theology and truths, but you can't bring him down when it's all you. Is that, you know, and when I say all you, you know, I realize you're born again and you're safely going to purgatory. Just kidding. Just kidding. So just to read a few scriptures, Luke 11, 1 and 2. And this will show, you know, this isn't even the introduction. This is Luke 11, verse 1 and 2. Okay. Actually, I think I only got verse 2 down here. But verse 1 says something like this. Teach us to pray. Okay, y'all remember that? Y'all got your Bible open. Kelly, how's that read, verse 1? Okay, so you got Jesus praying. And they're going, there's something different about his prayers. And that was brought up somewhere, you know, that you pray different than the Pharisees. And so they say, teach us to pray. All right, now, this is so important because our prayers are about everything but this. And maybe we pray this, you know, sometimes, but they said, teach us to pray. And Jesus said, this is it. He you know, they said, teach us to pray. And he said, I'm going to teach you what to pray. That's going to be a prayer. That's true prayer. That's what the Father wants to hear. All right, so verse 2, and he said unto them, when you pray, say, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. All right, so what are we talking about here? We're talking about this process of that which is settled, bringing it into the earth. We're talking about that, and we're talking about, see, we can call Jesus the kingdom, not just the king of the kingdom. He is the kingdom where we are supposed to dwell. And that's the only place that his government will be over us. In him, because we're enfolded into the one that has all that the Father wants. And he'll manifest that through us. But we have to see everybody's looking for the kingdom down here. He says, thy kingdom come. Jesus says, here's how you pray about the kingdom. Or here's how you pray. Stop praying for help. Stop praying to get something or be, you know, have somebody that's gonna get you through or this or that. And start praying this, that this enfolding, this incorporating that took place into the environment known as Jesus Christ would come down into my earth. And it would be just like it is in heaven. Okay? Not the best picture that any Christian in earth can do it. You know what I mean? Because we compare one with another and we go, oh, they, you know, this or that. Or we look at them, we go, well, I, you know. No. As it is, we want this reality as it is, not as taught by Randy Nussbaum or books by me or anyone else. And here's why. Not just because Jesus is sovereign, not just because Jesus is number one, but I got news for you here. He's the only one, and we're in him. See? But not just because all of that, but because he's the fullness that filleth all and in all, and there is no fullness outside of him, and every attempt that we have of grasping something in the scriptures and based on an environment in this earth, and trying to make it real is futile. And that's just a fact. It's futile. It's not going to happen. God set it up that way. And Jesus said when he got down to him, he said, man, you know, what should we pray? Okay. Well, first, he didn't say this, but basically it's stop praying all the stuff you're praying because you're praying based on premises that cannot happen. They cannot come to pass. Okay. So your heart, because this isn't a head issue, because it's a head issue, he's your head, but it's not a mental academic issue. It is when the heart turns to the Lord, then you see his face, then you'll be changed. Then you see him. You see his face, and in seeing his face, you're comprehending the one, and this is heading toward the truth of the labor, the one that I am. Now, you're not Christ, but you're one with him, and that's who you are. That's who you are. You're one with this one here. But if we don't know him, if we don't know him, not in the way that as he is, then how can as he is be brought down into earth? I mean, how can that happen? It cannot happen. It is impossible. And all of our work and all of our searching and all of our ministries and all of those things, you know, they lack the vital element, seed of God, life, true life, his life. You see, it's not just, well, I'm excited about this. You ever have someone say something like that and you go, well, is that life or is that you're just excited because you like this particular area or something like that, you know? The life. Okay, so one more verse. I hope I can get this one in. Hebrews 8, verse 5 and 6. Hebrews 8, 5 and 6. Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry. And just stop right there. Okay, I'll refer to that. All right. So here's what happened. Moses saw this, saw the reality, and I don't know they saw in Christ, but you understand what I mean. He saw the heavenly reality. And so he made it according to pattern in the earth. Okay, well, he was correct to do that because the Lord said, that's what I want you to do. But they began to serve the shadow and the example, not this reality. There's the, it looks correct. The pieces are correct. The order is correct, but they have not seen what Moses saw. Okay. Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to this thing that you saw up here in the mount. Make it all according to that. Okay. Because in reality, it is supposed to be after, if you will, after the image, but it's not just an image, it is a flow down of reality. It is a flowing down of reality. It's not just shadows, or we'll be doing the same thing the Jews did. And then verse 6 starts with this, but now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry. Okay, if you read on, you're gonna miss something here. This is, and he is stating that this is the more excellent ministry. And we're going to talk about it sometime or another, second go round or something. We're going to look at this excellent ministry as opposed to the shadow ministry. Praise God. Okay, so one final statement, talking about the priest getting ready to set up that tabernacle. They are living it together in the earth, bringing it down into the earth. And so they're setting up their they're laying the skins out, and they're getting the stakes, and they're getting the brass poles that the brass serpent was put on, which represented Christ crucified. And it's all going up, and it's all, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men, and it's all going up, and the skins being stressed, and the stakes are driving that into the ground like Christ crucified, setting it up and saying, by doing it, we're together, we're priests, we're trying to bring this into the earth. We invite all the rest of Israel to come and enter in and find the way. Find the way. Amen. Okay, so let's stop and take a little break and...